Hello, everybody. We are here in the virtual room for the Expert Talks webinar organized by the European Cluster Collaboration Platform, and we will start within shortly. I think it's according to my time monitoring, it's precisely 16:00, but we will give just one more minute for the newcomers, and then we will start. So it's time now. And I would like to start by saying, dear participants, welcome to the third webinar from the series ECCP Expert Talks that will address today the hot topic of digitalization. And we don't want to look at it as a general issue, but in particular to the challenges and opportunities that are out there for the SMEs. Being the European Cluster Collaboration Platform, of course, it is very important for us to look at the cluster perspectives, what role clusters can play in the process. And this is why we invited today two experts to share their knowledge in the area with you, with members of the cluster community. First, I have the pleasure to invite Katarina Kosiol, Enterprise and Single Market Advisor at the SME United, who, after a short introduction of SME United, will address not only the challenges faced by SMEs related to digitalization, but also trends and opportunities. Whereas after Katarzyna, we will have Frank Bösenberg, Managing Director of Silicon Saxony Cluster in Germany, so directly a cluster perspective, who will touch issues related to the challenges faced by his cluster regarding the uptake of digital technologies, and as well introduce the German D-Hub, a digital hub initiative, and what are the possible connections and synergies that can be made between the two initiatives. Before I give the floor to Katarzyna, I would like to mention that this session is recorded. And next week, we will produce a short summary of the discussions and the presentations made today. And you will also have the possibility to listen again to the whole recording. The questions are welcome after the two presentations, and you have the possibility to either raise your hand virtually or on the panel that you can see, or write your questions in the respective field questions. So now I will give you the word to Katarzyna. Katarzyna, just a second. It looks that my, as usual, a technical problem occurs where my escape button refuses to work. Just a second. It is unbelievable. Everything works fine. Now we are. Here we are. Here is Katarzyna's presentation ready to start. So, Katarzyna, the floor is yours.
Perfect. That was very smooth. Good afternoon, Lucia, Frank, and the whole clusters community. Thank you very much for this opportunity to share our experience and perspective on the topic. We are not a cluster. We are SME organization that represents SMEs here in Brussels, but also in European countries. We are our members. So we might have maybe a little bit different views sometimes. Maybe sometimes we are a little bit to Brussels. So it will be very interesting to exchange with you and also learn from next speaker what's going on the ground. So please, next slide. Next slide.
Yes, it's. I'm here. I'm definitely trying to use this. Never. It's.
So while Lucia is fixing the background slide, which is very nice,
let's try to fix the issue. Yes.
Yes, fantastic.
Yes.
So those are some data points which you probably know quite well about SMEs in Europe, the big majority of enterprises. Within 93% are micro. Employ two-thirds of workforce, and indeed the backbone of the European economy. Can I have a next slide?
Yes.
So we, SME United, we are the voice of crafts and SMEs in Europe. We are representing the interest of SMEs towards European institutions. We're Brussels-based, but we're also a European social partner and recognized employees organization. And with our members and via our members, we also work in countries. Our mission is to shape Europe for SMEs and shape SMEs for Europe. If I can have the next slide. I will tell you that we have around 70 member organizations in 30 countries, where indirectly we represent 12 million enterprises, so more or less half of enterprises, and 55 million employees. And to sum up, what we do is, of course, mostly regulatory monitoring and advocacy and lobbying, but also capacity building for SME organizations and SMEs, as well as projects. Thank you. So typical SME in Europe is usually having a website, is active on social media, also tries to exploit selling online the e-commerce opportunities. Still, of course, bigger companies are far more advanced with it. Also, SMEs are trying to sell more and more via online marketplaces, so some external websites. Some SMEs are using other technologies such as cloud, electronic information sharing, and big data analytics. Those technologies are perceived as a like kind of motor of growth, while, for example, cybersecurity is an absolute need with the times of more and more threats and risks. Okay. So large companies are more digitalized than SMEs. So there are still many areas for SMEs where there are opportunities that could be exploited. According to recent survey, around 90% of SMEs consider themselves lagging behind in digital innovation. There are, of course, very big discrepancies between sectors, but also countries when it comes to uptake and deployment of technologies. Here below on the slide, you have some recent data from DESI, so Digital Economy and Society Index, which was published a week ago. And the chapter on integration of digital technology, you have here comparison between large enterprises and SMEs, excuse me, when it comes to integration of technologies. So, thank you. Having this background, and now more related to our experience as Voice of SMEs and Crafts in Europe. we can tell that among those 24 million of SMEs, we find some that are front runners, they're developing technologies. Others are following. They are more used to traditional systems, but they are also adapting to transformation. And then at the end, you have quite big group of SMEs that are lagging behind, but also are overwhelmed actually by the radical developments. Also in this group, you would have some of companies for whom their current business model works pretty well and it's successful, so they don't feel like they should change anything. Okay. And SMEs are not are very, very different group, and then that also reflects the uptake of technology, different internal capacities, resources, and also because of this, the challenges are different. They need different support measures according to their size and already in place level of digitalization. We have here study units at SME United, and we're making every half a year a barometer checking the business climate in Europe. But from time to time, we make some special surveys. And in at the beginning of 2018, we made a survey, Future of Europe, and then we asked for the biggest challenges. We got around 30,000 replies, and as you can see on the slide, digitalization is perceived as one of the biggest challenges for SMEs. And what is more, it seems that EU help would be very much appreciated to help to tackle the challenge. Next slide, please.
Looks. Just a second. Mm-hmm. It looks like there is a problem with the file. I think it might.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you can go on while I still try to fix the slide. I'm terribly sorry.
Okay.
Thank you.
So if we can relate to our yes. Thank you. Yes. If you could also minimalize a little bit echo. Oh, now it's perfect. Sorry. So if you could, we could relate to our experience, you know, years of working and representing of SMEs. There are a few conditions that help SMEs digitalizing. First of all is, of course, appropriate infrastructure, reliable telecommunication networks, especially and also in rural areas, because there are places where SMEs are present and they need connectivity. Also e-government solutions. Simple and secure. When it comes to e-government, it's also important for SMEs to, however, having this possibility to have also possibility to access government offline, so two streams. Access to talent and skills is very important. Here we also touch upon education and training systems and a little bit lacking skills forecasts on different levels, national, European, but also very, very local, because the modernizing of education system and offer of training should really follow the needs of the market, of needs of SMEs, and it would be very much appreciated if a business, but also small businesses, would be more engaged in designing the training offers, especially with EU-funded, you know, possibilities like structural funds and so on. Also, continuous learning should be encouraged. Also, standardization is quite an important issue for SMEs. And we, as SME United, we're actually involved in small business standards initiative because standardization help with technology development and with compliance, it actually opens the door to international market for SMEs. Next slide. We also talk a lot about, of course, financial support.
There is always a problem when I'm muted, that the computer relationship between muting and...
Thank you very much. No worries, we'll be patient. So, yes, support for investments in innovative solutions is needed. SMEs are looking actually also, as they operate very often locally or nationally, at the support on their level, so regional and national. And the point before, which is last but definitely not least, the whole capacity building and access to know-how to information. You know, it's much appreciated when information is in one place. When the organizations of SMEs are involved, and of course all the possibilities for raising awareness, for providing tailored information to SMEs are much needed. And this whole point refers to my next point, which is on next slide.
Working on it.
So what we see when it comes to, you know, the next MFF, the funds and support actually kind of created by European Commission, but also other, also member states, it's slowly moving, of course, in good direction. And there is actually a lot of options. So for the uptake of digital technology is also producing new solutions and deploying, you will find some budget lines in the European Regional Development Fund, in Cohesion Fund, in European Social Fund, this especially for skills. That's later this will be translated for operational programs by member states and at the end, finally, to projects. Then you have central funds, such as Invest EU Fund, where you get microloans and loans and other financial support. The very new program, Digital Europe program, with five streams, four more maybe important, actually three maybe more important for SMEs, artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, and advanced digital skills. And also the single market program, where actually the big amount of money would be also given to support the digital transformation SMEs. And more or less linked to the funds, but also to some other initiatives, you would have digital innovation hubs, and I believe our next speaker is one of them, European Cybersecurity Competence Network and Center. There is also Enterprise Europe Network. There are clusters. There is also the whole movement and initiative of European Institute of Innovation and Technology with EIT Digital, where they support new products and so on. So actually, there are many, many possibilities. Also, on national level, you would also find some national initiatives. That at the end, this whole picture starts to be very, very complex and really difficult to navigate, because you would have among, for example, the digital innovation hubs, not every hub will be specialized in every technological solution. They will not be always close. Cybersecurity center is also on different level. So what we see and what we get from our members' signals is that actually the whole picture is very, very complex and is actually reaching the SMEs that are already either familiar with whole European funds and possibilities, or are actually quite advanced with technology and they understand. And the whole part of SMEs that are not even aware that they can change and they can go with digital transformation in supported manner are a little bit left behind. And I'm really interested what the next speaker would say about it, but this is our experience. And when it comes to some help on more local level, if I can have next slide.
We're starting to unmute to make it work somehow. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. So one of our members, of course, is coordinating a network of competence centers for mostly for crafts, which is funded by Federal Ministry for Economic Affairs. It's of course in Germany. They have several centers where their target group are actually mostly crafts or really small companies that are quite traditional and usually not really aware about the whole fantastic world of digitalization. What they do, they tackle simple topics such as social media and so on. You could see on their website, actually, they have a whole calendar of initiatives, but also more advanced. The whole point is that it is a really tailored and, of course, resource taking exercise, but thanks to this, the companies are getting answers to their questions, and they can also experiment with technology, and they go through this transformation. So this is some part which is reaching really not converted yet, not maybe evangelized, and it's one of actually really really good practices in Europe. I can have next slide. So, of course, we're talking about SMEs that they are lagging behind in the digital transformation, but there are also other disruptive effects of digitalization on the economy that needs to be addressed, and they are very important for SMEs. It's more maybe it's more regulatory zone. So, you know, there is a whole question of fairness, transparency, and keeping the and enabling level playing field for all companies in Europe. And I just wanted to give you two examples of issues where we're also tackling here, platformization of economy and keeping the market balance. You're probably quite aware about the recently agreed regulation promoting fairness and transparency for business users of online intermediation services, so-called the platform to business regulation. This regulation addressed such as issues such as unilateral trading practices that were harmful for SMEs, like, you know, ranking offers and SMEs on the website, termination of accounts, changes terms and conditions. We were much involved in those in supporting Commission with preparing this proposal, of course, and then working with Parliament and Council on making sure it happens, because it's very needed and time it was still timely. Then there are other emerging issues that are growing, for example, the data economy and whole area of access to data. You know that data is very valuable for all businesses. Thanks to data, businesses can improve their models, but they can also develop and still improve products and services. When it comes to access to data, this is still a little bit gray area, where at the end, the terms and conditions are determining who's using the data, and usually they're not dictated by SMEs, but actually SMEs are the users and they are in the weakened positions. And we have several signals from especially certain sectors that there is something to do, because for SMEs, as they are weaker, it's really difficult to tackle this issue, to grow and so on. This is especially repair and maintenance sector, of course, elevators, automotive, and on. So this, I wanted to just give you a little bit of taste here of other consequences of digital disruption that are also important for SMEs, and they are not not strictly maybe related to the uptake of technologies and so on, but more for use and this legal part. So that would be all from my side when it comes to my presentation for the moment. Over to you, Lucia.
Thank you very much, Katarzyna. And I have to say that I myself am an SME, and I definitely need some help in learning to master better the digitalization. And apologies to the participants to the webinar for the problems created, but obviously there is a problem when with a moderation panel and how my computer reacts to this order. Now, I will again have difficulty going back to the to the other slides. Frank, shall I try to give you, maybe it would be better if I give you the screen, the possibility to have the screen on your side and do the presentation, or shall we continue the same way as we did with Katarzyna?
Just continue the way it is, as we did test this before. And I have two screens, not to disturb here the participants.
Okay. So we go now to the presentation from a cluster perspective. Again, from the very beginning, and here we have Frank Rosenberg with us to talk about digitalization challenges. Thank you, Frank.
Yes, a warm welcome also from my side, and also thanks to you, Katarzyna, for the nice presentation, setting the scene. In my presentation, I will quickly introduce the cluster that I'm heading, which is Silicon Saxony. I will introduce the digital innovation hub that we set up and that I'm involved in also, and then come to a very precise example on how we support, I can't even say our members, but our ecosystem in implementing the digital transformation. And I'm looking forward, of course, to questions afterward. So first, or next slide, please. So first of all, and I guess all cluster managers of you know this phenomena, we have to distinguish between our ecosystem and the actual cluster organization. And Silicon Saxony, sometimes luckily, sometimes unluckily, is used for both terms, basically. So the key figures that you find here below, 2,400 companies, 64,000 employees, and 17 billion euro turnover are the figures for the ecosystem, which is in fact one of the biggest ICT ecosystems in Europe, with core competences in microelectronics production, but we also have a really quickly growing software scene. And on the next slide, these are the figures for our association, for the real cluster organization. So you see not 2,400 members anymore, but 342. Of course, all the big ones are in as well. So our 342 members have almost half of the employees of the entire ecosystem. We are almost 20 years old. So we are young adults as a cluster. We are independent. That's important to understand. As a cluster organization, we are not state funded. We are fully run by private funds, by membership fees, or by services that we sell to our members and beyond. That we do not so bad is shown by the cluster management excellence label, which we renewed for the third time now. And our core competencies, as I already pointed out, are micro and nanoelectronics, ICT, and software. So next slide, please. As all cluster or real cluster organizations that I know, we have the same split up between members. So the vast majority is SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprises. We have some big players. We have some research institutes or chair of universities, a few natural persons. The field of startups has played a bigger role in the last years. So we have some dedicated startups and also a special membership scheme for them. And of course, we also have some public institutions or other networks as members. Next slide, please. Here you see what are famous brand names. What is important to understand also in relation to the hub, because this was a kind of birth hour, is that we have crossover memberships with some non-ICT related networks. So BioSaxony is our life science cluster. Bitkom is the National IT Association, SEMI is the Global Semiconductor Association. So some are within the sector, but we also have cross-cluster collaboration schemes, so to say. So we always have two claims as Silicon Saxony. We are first more than just an industry association. We are a cluster. I don't have to explain what this means in the cluster community. And we are more than just silicon. So we do not just semiconductor anymore, but a little bit more. Next slide, please. 2.5 years ago, I think the terminus of digital innovation hubs was evolving by that time at European level. Also, the German national government, triggered by the National IT Association, decided that for mastering digital transformation, so-called DE hubs or hubs would be the solution. And they made a kind of competition within Germany, where we participated with our core location, I would say, Dresden. It's in Saxony, and you see here, it's the eastern part of Germany. So one of the hubs is now located also in Dresden. And on the next slide, you will see how this is seen from the national authorities, because in Germany, there was also a leading edge cluster competition. So there are established clusters, and of course the community in Germany asked already 2 years ago, what's the distinction between a cluster and a hub? And the answer that was found and spreaded in Germany is that clusters are fine. They combine SMEs and R&D and flagships, so big companies, and also are responsible for smart talents, so staff acquisition, etc., etc. What comes on top in a hub are two things major, or mostly. One is the entire field of startups as drivers of new ideas, connected also with the topic of VC, venture capital, and real test beds. So whether this is somehow related to infrastructure, basically. So it's not about not just about techs or simple events. So, but a hub always need to have a kind of test bed or some physical infrastructure. It's important to understand that the e-hubs, which are promoted also outside Germany as the German digital innovation hubs, never received this national state funding. If they are funded regionally. So this is important to understand that even though all 16 hubs, no, officially it's 12 hubs in 16 locations, as if you go one slide back quickly, you see that some of the hubs have a kind of double location. So for instance, we are together with another bigger city in, basically it's bigger than Dresden, big city in Saxony, it's Leipzig. And we have a so-called double hub, smart systems, smart infrastructure. Another example is Frankfurt am Main and Darmstadt, which brings together fintech and cybersecurity in two locations, basically. So there are 12 hubs officially in 16 locations. And now next slide and then the next. So they are regionally funded mostly, which makes them not all one-on-one comparable. So they found slightly different concepts. Our concept was to partner up with local or even regional organizations that could bring in lacking capabilities. So you see here, in the three circles, these are the shareholders of our digital innovation hub. We set up a new legal entity, a private company, basically. We are one of the shareholders. We put in the 5G lab of Germany, which is a group of more than 200 researchers on 5G, so one important technology when it comes to digitalization. And then high-tech Startbahn could be translated with high-tech runway. That's an organization that is dedicated to the growth of startups. So their core business is to support startups or to accelerate the growth of startups and very young companies. Then we teamed up with other initiatives, and Katarzyna already mentioned that there's a lot of initiatives on European level. And I guess it's the same in all of your regions. There's mostly also a lot of initiatives on local or regional level. So we tried to team up with all of them. For the sake of visibility, and set up this so-called smart systems hub. And now next slide, please. And why is this necessary? While our region, Saxony, in general is a region which is very favorable in terms of innovation, so we are under the strong innovators, or even at the borderline to innovation leaders. If you look at the monitoring report on digitalization, it's a national report from Germany. If you go to the next slide, please. Then you will find Germany not at all in a leading position. So in general, Germany is a little bit lagging. At least the spread within Germany is very, very, very big. We have, of course, leading suppliers of digitalization solutions, but in particular in our region, the number of lagging SMEs is considerably high, or the spread is at least very, very large, and we are definitely not at the top end of European regions if it comes to digitalization. So next slide, please. The all important question now is what can be done, and setting up this digital innovation hub is one of the means. And you see here the strategic goals of the hubs is really the creation of an IoT ecosystem by connecting all the capabilities that we have locally and regionally first. The special circumstances in Saxony is that we have the hardware production, the software production, or software companies, and connectivity know-how. So all that you need for building smart systems or IoT systems is available locally from the technology provider point of view. The bad side of this story is that these are literally free communities still. They are not yet that connected as they could be. And one of the objectives of this hub is to connect these three communities to really one, and then to foster digitalization within our own region and of course also beyond. Next slide, because I still have to answer the question, how we do this. And as I said, our hub is funded regionally. Of course, our regional government also is well aware of the fact that we have a lot of SMEs that are either following or even lagging behind in digitalization. So they said, okay, one of the jobs of the hub is to preach for digitalization and to help SMEs to digitalize their whatever, huh? But mostly production. We have a lot of small companies that do some specific production and could be digitalized. So what did we do? As we also have a lot of companies that support others in digitalization, funny enough, their clients are mostly outside our region. We set up a concept which is called trails, really like in a jungle, because that's what it is as a unexperienced SME. We have a lot of topics that are related to digitalization, maybe. And if you even if you start to Google, it's a lot of information and it's like a jungle. And we decided to set up trails through this jungle dedicated to specific either technologies or application areas that makes it easier for the companies to make their way. In a long and strategic discussion, we decided that this preaching, so making them aware of the fact that they have to digitalize to survive, is not our highest priority. So to be honest, we focus more on the followers, and companies that do not realize that they have to digitalize or that do not make this their own priority are also not that much in our priority. Because it's really, really, really difficult to convince someone of an advantage if he doesn't see the necessity. So next slide, please. One of the examples of such a trail is at the same time that the required test bed and the physical infrastructure. It's called the industrial IoT test bed. It's a small area, you see it on the picture. It's like a small fab where you have a fully digitalized and automated production of, in that case, electronic products in a discrete production, and you have a lot of different technologies in particular in industrial IoT that you can look at and that you can even try out for your own requirements. In this environment, there are on a regular basis workshops we run on, for instance, data-driven business models, on RFID in manufacturing, on lean production, or we also have Wi-Fi or Li-Fi, so it's a connection technology related to light. So light is used to transmit data is very secure. It works very well in the industrial environment. We have some indoor navigation and indoor location systems there in place. And you can literally play with this as a as an SME for comparably little costs. That's the big advantage. So next slide, please. And now I come to the core of our digital innovation hub. So I have to explain the diagram a little bit. There are a lot of potential formats where you could bring together companies or where you could implement innovation and also digitalization. And they differ in relation to the effort that you need and also to the benefit that they bring. And what we have in our region already is this co-opetition. It's on the upper right. It's really a mixer between cooperation and competition. So if you have two strong players in exactly the same spot, you see that this helps on a regular basis. Very prominent examples in other sector, I would say, is football teams. If you look at where huge football teams are coming from, sometimes you have a second huge football team in even exactly the same city. So that's the biggest thing, but that's of course also difficult to create. And on the lower end, you have this short pitch formats where people present something, you have this and you have experienced this on, I don't know, B2B matchmakings or whatever. And Fingerton now is a really new format, which was piloted and now run for the second time. We'll do a third time later on, and I will explain you a little bit on detail what this meant and what we could achieve and why I'm also personally fully convinced that this is a very good way of helping, let's say, small and micro companies up to medium-sized companies in digitalization. In our case, it's a 4 days full-time program. So it usually starts on Monday and ends on Thursday. And full-time means we have a schedule that is planned from, say, 9 to 5, but the teams that are being set up usually work longer. Sometimes they work even within the night. So in the last two versions, we had 40 participants, so 4 to 5 working teams, and then also 10 to 5 coaches or experts for specific technological topics. It's not surprising that these are sometimes also a kind of sales engineers for their own technologies. Huh? So people that of course can sell, but their major profession is to be an engineer and they consult in the teams. We also combine this with students and try to mix up, or not, we didn't try this, we managed, we succeeded in this, we mixed up different skill groups. So concept and methods thinking, creative product designers and developers. And you might have heard this from hackathons. So it's a similar approach where this is done on a pure software level. As I already told you, that we also have hardware producers. In the case of the Thinkathon, that's the G in the Thinkathon, there's always a thing involved, a physical hardware that can be used in digitalization. And to make it a little bit more practical or imaginable, please the next slide. So this was the first one, IoT for energy. And this is also the distinction between us as a cluster organization and the hub. The Smart Systems Hub is our, from the point of view as a cluster manager, it's our institution to reach up to application areas. We are basically a technology cluster. I know there are also application clusters. We are technology clusters, so most of our companies provide technology. And they are constantly looking for applicants. With the hub, and with the concept of the hub, we managed to reach out to application areas. Energy was the first one, and then please go on, because it's I guess it's an animated slide. Yes, so on the right hand side, it's the application area. It's an energy service provider from our ecosystem. Admittedly, this is not an SME, so we piloted it with a little bit larger company. On the left-hand side, you have a good mix of small and medium-sized enterprises, Exelonics, Cloud and Heat, and also the very big ones, so SAP. Next slide, please. Yes, these were the coaches. So they really set up the teams and they get the challenge, or basically they got four challenges. And then in a kind of competition, they worked for 4 days, starting with design thinking on solving these challenges, setting up a prototype and presenting this on the fourth day in front of a jury, really type of competition. In the case of our first Thinkathon, all four challenges came from the same challenge provider, one energy provider. And next slide. And in the end, you have some impressions from the Thinkathon. And next slide, also a winner. Just to give you an idea what this is all about, it was gamification approach to the use of green electricity. The rationale behind was that electricity can be created, or the electricity generation is decentralized more and more, but also the energy providers can provide green energy, but they need to incentivize or gives incentives to the users of this energy, and they develop a kind of game which enables this problem. Technologies used was a cloud by SAP, then really easy technology from Raspberry Pi, and blockchain. Next slide, because this is even more important with regard to digitalization, and made the link to SMEs. We had quality assurance in production with artificial intelligence. And there we had, again, four teams, and this time four challenges from four companies. Infineon, as a admittedly again big one, but we also had challenges from really small producing companies that we identified by making use of our personal network that we have as cluster managers in the region. And I missed that point, but Silicon Saxony has 12 full-time staff members. So of course this couldn't have been managed by myself alone, but together with my team, we identified three more companies beside our member Infineon that gave challenges into this, I would say, construct, because you don't even know beforehand who will try to tackle your challenge. What made them work with us was the simple point that they didn't have to pay 40,000 euro that they would have to pay to KPMG or Deloitte or you name it to have a first pilot study of their needs, etc. Still, the results were at the same quality level after 4 days. And yeah, that's our format, the Thinkathon, bringing together solution providers and people that are, to stay in the terms of Katarzyna, are fast followers of digitalization, SMEs. If you want to picture this by yourself, you are invited to join us in November, because then you will implement the next Thinkathon. And I guess that's the end of my presentation. Is there one more slide? Yeah, lessons learned maybe. That's important. In the challenges, it was important in 4 days. You cannot change the world in 4 days, even though you can achieve a lot. But we need to work together with our challenge providers on complexity reduction. So we made it as simple as needed, not as simple as possible. The team setup was really crucial. We learned this, and the heterogeneity in the teams was that what make the teams so quick. And heterogeneity in or really all aspects. So it's really also not only a students team, but there were experienced developers from established companies from our ecosystem also in the teams. And last but not least, the coaching on the technologies that are provided made the teams perform so well that this is a concept that I'm totally convinced of. Yeah, but this was really the last slide. Yes. So only remains me to thank you and look forward to your questions. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Frank, for the very precise and detailed presentation. Thank you very much for addressing as well the relationship between clusters and the digital hub. We have one question from Marcos asking about how to differentiate traditional clusters versus digital ecosystems. Maybe you could go again into a bit more into this question as well, into more detail.
Yes, I mean, this depends. I mean, as a cluster manager, you usually always have to distinguish between your ecosystem and your cluster organization, unless you are in an economic development agency and by definition, all people in your area belong to your cluster. In our case, the relationship between the ecosystem and our real organization is by membership fees. So there are clusters that do ICT, but do not pay membership fee, so they are not. That's the distinction in our case between ecosystem and organization, and that's the same basically on the level of the Digital Innovation Hub. In the ecosystem, usually all people in the area are there that belong to a given topic. By definition, you cannot change this. In the case of our Digital Innovation Hub, we do not have a membership strategy, as we, of course, wouldn't have been extremely happy as a cluster organization. We have a real client partnership. So as the hub adds value or provides added value services to the SMEs, they are willing to pay.
Right.
So it's a pure client relationship.
Maybe I can go a bit more in detail. What is the business model? How do you run them? You said clients are paying.
I already said this. So we have it's a mixed business model of the hub. As a part is funded by the region. Basically, these parts pays also marketing and also our efforts to reach out to companies that are not yet involved in the hub. Then we have four, we call them core partners. These are the big companies from our ecosystem that for different reasons participate. So it's SAP in our case, a big software company. It's Infineon. You might notice if you're on Microelectronics and Global Foundries, it's less known from Microelectronics, but as big as the others. And T-Systems is a daughter, it's a daughter company of Telecom. These four players pay a considerable amount, and then we really charge SMEs for our services. So also, if you take part or if give your challenge in a Thinkathon as an SME, you will have to pay a small amount. And small amount means we really have a pricing advantage to usual innovation or digitalization consulting companies, due to cluster effects in the end. So it's a mixed model, but it's a not-for-profit company, but still it has an entrepreneurial and lean startup thinking behind.
Thank you very much. Very useful. And hopefully, you know, through this sharing of knowledge, it could be inspirational for other clusters in Europe in this area to learn from you and see how such a model could be introduced in their regions. There is another question from the audience, but I have a question for Katarzyna. It would be maybe interesting to say, based on the experience you have, what did you find out that works when it comes to supporting SMEs with taking up digital solutions? Are there any recommendations that you could make?
Thank you very much. Yes, indeed. So what I was already, I think, telling a little bit before, from our experience with working with SMEs, when SME will have some problems with either some program or something, or they are interested actually on changing something, improve, bring some solution, the first person they would ask, it would be accountant. And of course, you keep this in mind that 93% of SMEs are actually very small companies, micro. So first person they would talk with would be accountant. Then second, where they would search for advice would be actually SME organization. And as you know, in some countries, SMEs mandatorily are members of SME organizations, in some more voluntary. But they would go there to seek for knowledge in, because it's in their own language. It would be more personalized and it's more local. And that's something that needs to be addressed. And I'm really interested what Frank said about that. Actually, they are not doing convincing the unconvinced services. They already work with more convinced ones and help them improve. And if I may, I would like to ask a question to Frank. How are you making any actions to actually outreach to SMEs? You would then maybe have more clients, but also if you're the digital innovation hub, if in understanding of European Commission, there will be more, I think, pressure on you then to outreach to more and more SMEs. How are you going to do it? Maybe we can help you in a way. I would be much interested as well in getting to know this.
Yes, you mentioned this this German initiative on a very low level digitalization, and this is indeed mm-hmm. existing. So it's a not even strategic, it's a tactical decision by us to not approach these companies as they are approached by either the Chamber of Commerce or the Chamber of Craftsmanship, which do have respective initiatives. And there's even a German initiative called Competence Center Mittelstand, which is SME, which also offers support, low level support and missionizing, convincing SMEs of the need to digitize. They do not support the mid-end or the high-end. And we have decided that the Digital Innovation Hub shall serve as a kind of lighthouse model. For the low-end, there are other institutions, namely that you already mentioned, that in Germany, companies are mandatory part of and that address this issue already. And of course, mm-hmm. we cooperate with them in information exchange. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, that answers my question. I was just wondering, because that's the model, very German model, where you have all the structures in place. And I'm just wondering, because you know the Hubs initiative is now spreading around Europe, and how there in other countries, especially Eastern Europe, how this all will be replicable and how it will work at the end.
We did some international outreach already as a cluster and also as a hub. What I realized in a lot of other European regions, not only in the Western or Southern countries, Italy, France, but also in Czech Republic or in Poland, usually you have more than one supporting organization for SMEs. And even locally, originally, what makes the region successful is the level of extent they cooperate with each other. And I mean, our role model now is Estonia. Huh? Mm-hmm. They definitely never had the financial resources that Germany had, but in terms of digitalization, they are far advanced. So it's not a question of pure money. It's a question of agility or of the capability to cooperate between different mm-hmm. entities. And we also face this sometimes even causes or still not even it. It still causes problems also in Germany. Huh? If mm-hmm. if you have people in the respective organization that think that they are the only one, then this will hinder the success.
Okay, thank you very much. We still have 2 minutes, and there is a question from the audience. How to overcome time and resource constraints in smaller industrial SMEs, especially in the countryside, to participate in the thinkathons.
And it's a question too.
The problem is what we usually answer to companies that come like this is how do you eat an elephant piece by piece, and that's admittedly a challenge for SMEs. I mean, if they have to change everything, their business model, their skill profile, everything, it's impossible, or at least it's impossible within 6 months, but it is possible within 2 or 3 years. It's a matter of strategic planning of the respective CEO, and what we do then is there's a kind of checklist. We say, okay, what can be digitalized? What is the low end? And you had this in the slides already by Katarzyna with the social media profile as one mean of electronic marketing, and the high end is a fully automated production maybe. And you can check the real individual production environment or their company environment, and then make a kind of list what would be possible, and then you have to prioritize, pick one or two things and make them step by step. And what we always do is we try to choose commonly the things that have the quickest wins. I mean, as a small company, you have to have a return on this investment, and even if it's only a time investment, you have to have a return as soon as possible or as quick as possible. But prioritization or simple. It sounds simple. It's not simple, but strategy work is the answer to this challenge.
Thank you very much. Particularly, thank you very much for you too, Katarzyna and Frank. Thank you very much to the audience for staying with us to listen to such interesting discussions and inspiring. In case you are interested to get in touch with the speakers, next week we will publish the presentations as well as the recording of the session. So feel free to continue a direct dialogue if you need more information on this topic. And with this, we are closing today's webinar. Again, saying a big thank you to you two for your contribution. Thank you and goodbye, and hope to stay in touch within the cluster community. Next.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.